Good afternoon. So directly going into the topic, so today we shall be discussing about psoriatic arthritis. So I shall be concentrating more on how to pick up a case of psoriatic arthritis. We see a lot of patients who come with joint symptoms. Many patients, they don't really volunteer that they have a skin lesion. We have to search for it because they don't think that the skin problem and the joint lesion, like arthritis are connected. So if they voluntarily tell or if the psoriasis is very claricating, sometimes or many times, the psoriasis patch might be somewhere which we will not be able to see. We may not be able to fully examine all the patient in our busy OPD. So these are the things which we will be seeing. One is how to approach it, what is the criteria we should use to diagnose, how imaging will help, what are the current treatment which is available, and of course, always the previous lot of discussion going about statins, aspirin. So most of these patients with inflammatory arthritis, they never come only with inflammatory arthritis. They also have a diabetes, hyperthyroidism, hyperuricemia, hypertension, or a coronary artery disease. Already they will be on multiple pills. So that is a very important thing. And also a little bit on how to go about and what is the latest guidelines. So how to approach this? Most important thing whenever somebody comes with an inflammatory joint, like a joint pain, is to see whether the patient has an inflammatory joint symptoms or not. Because what we know is a mechanical thing which is very common, whereas the inflammatory joint pains are not so common. So always whenever a patient comes with, any patient comes with a peripheral arthritis like a hand joints or leg joints or even a back pain, first we have to differentiate this whether it's inflammatory or mechanical. So inflammatory means the patient will have a typical morning stiffness. Whenever they are in a period of inactivity is there, after that they will have more pain and stiffness. And with activity, it will slowly start easing down. So that is the typical history why we always keep on asking whether they have any uneasiness on getting up. So even in the afternoon also, if they are going to sleep, they will have that uneasiness after getting up. So that is how we have to first differentiate whether the patient has an inflammatory pain or it's a non-inflammatory pain. Because non-inflammatory pain like a petrolofemoral OA is very common rather than an inflammatory one. But if the patient is going to associate with swelling, then it becomes very easy. Definitely, obviously, the patient has a synovitis or arthritis. Next is how many joints are involved. This again plays a major role because we all know typically rheumatoid presents with the symmetrical polyarthritis. Rarely, of course, it can present with the oligo or monoarticular. But on the contrary, psoriatic always presents with more of an asymmetrical variety. It may not be really symmetrical. Only one of the joints may be involved in the hands or the legs. And typically, when you compare the upper limb and lower limb, usually the knee or the ankle joints will be commonly involved. Particularly, confusion comes whenever the joints in the foot are involved. Many times whenever a foot joint is involved, particularly males, we always think of a gouty arthritis. That too, psoriasis patients also have associated hyperuricemia. So another point we have to remember is any arthritis with uric acid is not always gout. We have to see whether the pattern is fitting with gout or not. So it can be even psoriatic arthritis. And most of the times patients, particularly if they have not an intermittent episodic arthritis and they are going to have a continuous symptom, we always have to think against gout even though the uric acid is elevated. Then how the digits are going to be involved. As I told, in rheumatoid usually we call it something like a rope pattern. Means the second, third, fourth, fifth, all the PAP joints or the MCP joints will be involved. Whereas in psoriatic, we call it something like a ray pattern. It's not a horizontal, rather a vertical involvement. The whole digit will be involved. Sometimes the MCP, PAP and even the DAP will be involved. And another important thing we have to remember is whenever the distal interphalangeal joint in the hand is involved, it has to be only two things. Either it has to be a psoriatic arthritis or it has to be osteoarthritis. In rheumatoid arthritis, it's very, very, very rare for the DAP joint to be involved. So these are some subtle clues with which we will be able to find out whether the patient is having a psoriatic or not. And as I told, usually they have more of a lower extremity symptom rather than upper extremity symptom. And one more important thing is there is something called enthesitis. Whenever the ligaments or a muscle attached to the bone, that particular place is called enthesis. Common is a plantar fasciitis. So again, plantar fasciitis is very common in females. Usually it will be unilateral. But if it is going to be bilateral, symmetrical, and they also have associated enthesitis like an Achilles tendinitis, or in the hand they might have a tennis elbow, or they might have a trochanteric bursitis. If there are two or three enthesis involved, always think of psoriatic arthritis or spondyloarthritis. Basically, spondyloarthritis is a group of condition under which you have ankylosing spondylitis, psoriatic arthritis, reactive arthritis, and also IBD associated arthropathy. So it is a broad upper lateral spondyloarthritis under which psoriatic comes. So whenever a patient has enthesitis, particularly bilateral plantar fasciitis, then always think of whether you are missing a spondyloarthritis or psoriatic arthritis. Because recently I had a patient, 1 year back, he had bilateral plantar fasciitis. He didn't have any arthritis. Then later he started having arthritis, and later he developed a skin lesion. So in autoimmune disease, there is no fixed pattern. Diseases can evolve over a period of time. It's not that always skin has to come, then the joint has to come. That is the usual pattern. Always psoriasis comes first, followed by the arthritis. But it can be the other way around also, and sometimes patient can have both together, means the joint and the skin can appear at the same time also. Then inflammatory back pain. So the major difference between rheumatoid and spondyloarthritis is inflammatory back pain. So whenever a patient tells morning time they have a low back pain with stiffness, or early morning the back pain disturbs their sleep, or alternating buttock pain, that is called as inflammatory back pain. So patient has a arthritis of the hand with the inflammatory back pain, it has to be psoriatic arthritis unless otherwise proved. Because in rheumatoid, we don't get a typical inflammatory back pain. Maybe later stages we might have a cervical involvement. It never involves the low back. So that is another important thing when we should think of psoriatic. And one more important thing is a family history of psoriasis. Usually somebody in the family might have, at least even if it's not a psoriatic arthritis, at least a psoriasis. Cutaneous psoriasis will be having, somebody will be there in the family. And another important thing is, hidden areas of psoriasis. So as I told, patient comes with just an arthritis, but they won't reveal about the skin lesion because we can't expect, they think that is something else. So always we have to see in certain areas whenever we suspect psoriatic arthritis. So this patient actually had it in the, once we asked only, told that he has a skin lesion, he had it around the umbilicus. Similarly, patient can have it in the scalp. So if you just brush the hair and see, just that scalp border we will be able to see, or behind the ears we can see. In females means infra mammary area, or in the perianal area, buttock area. These are some of the hidden areas where the patient will have psoriasis. So always when you think of psoriatic arthritis, also think of the hidden areas. So this is another thing, many times we might think this is just like ordinary dryness of the skin. So this patient actually has something called palmo plantar psoriasis. So if, again, she felt this is due to washing of the utensils, and she felt there is no relation to the arthritis. Again, it's our duty to pick up. So patient won't have skin lesions anywhere else. Only places they will have is in the palm and plantar. This one, this is something called as palmo plantar psoriasis. And this is actually a little bit severe. Sometimes it will be very subtle. Only the ulnar border alone they will be having some skin lesions. And one more thing is, psoriasis also involves the nails. So even if you are not able to pick up a skin lesion, always look for, you can see there are some pits. So whenever there are multiple pits are there in the nail, again think of psoriasis. This is all nail dystrophy, it is an advanced stage, this might be easier, but whereas if you pick up at this stage, it is a very early stage where you will be able to pick up a psoriasis. So I am not really going into detail. So what patient should have is the inflammatory joint pain. Along with that, they should have a skin lesion or the typical nail changes. And another most important thing is, we always tell, we always give a diagnosis called seronegative rheumatoid arthritis. Actually, seronegative rheumatoid arthritis is not, there is no specific way in which it's been defined. Many times it's just a term which we use when we don't get anything else or no other serology is positive. For example, that patient with seronegative rheumatoid arthritis in future might be a psoriatic, or in future they might be SLE. So any patient whom you have a difficult inflammatory arthritis, but the rheumatoid factor and anti-CCP is negative, always think of psoriatic arthritis also as one of the differential diagnoses, or at least in future you have to watch out whether they are developing psoriatic arthritis. So, and one more important thing is there is something called dactylitis. Like enthesitis, which I told is very specific for spondyloarthritis. Similarly, dactylitis is nothing but the swelling of the whole digit. It will be something like a sausage, the synovium, the surrounding tendons, tenosynovium, the soft tissue, everything will be swollen. So whenever you see a patient with dactylitis, usually commonly it has to be only two things, either psoriatic arthritis or if it is a short history it has to be reactive arthritis unless proved otherwise. There are some rare causes like tuberculosis, sarcoidosis, all are like more of exam questions, but for practical reason somebody has dactylitis, it has to be either a psoriatic or a reactive. It's if somebody has a documented dactylitis, that is enough to tell that patient has any one of these conditions. And in radiograph, usually in rheumatoid we think see more of juxtaarticular osteopenia erosions. Here we have a lot of new bone formation, that is the major difference between the two. So there erosion forms pretty early, here the erosions happen a little bit later. Most important thing is you see for periosteal new bone formation. So these are the different types. So there are some patients who, as I told, have nail psoriasis, they can have isolated only DAP arthritis, they won't have any other arthritis, only the distal interphalangeal joint will be involved. So as I told, it has to be either a OA osteoarthritis, AROC osteoarthritis, or a psoriatic arthritis. DAP joint alone is involved. The typical pattern or the common pattern is asymmetrical oligarthritis. They will have one knee, two ankle, or the mid tarsal joints will be involved. symmetrical polyarthritis will be a little bit challenging. We have to make sure we differentiate it from a rheumatoid arthritis. Arthritis mutilans is nothing but we don't want the patients to go into that stage. It's a severe deforming arthritis. Due to erosions, there will be telescoping of the joints. And this is a one, around 25% of the patient will also have that acetone, spondylarthritis like which they will have inflammatory back pain. So many times it won't be like this one separate pattern alone. It will be a combination of two or three of these patterns. That is how we see the patients in practice. So after the physical examination, we have to see what is the degree of disease extent. Then we have to go in for inflammatory markers. If you are very sure if the psoriasis is patches are there, no need to do a rheumatoid factor or anti-CCP. Then we have to go for imaging, synovial fluid analysis. Again, if it is a monoarthritis, you can go for a synovial fluid analysis to exclude infection. But to diagnose psoriatic arthritis, there is no need for a synovial fluid examination. So here you can see, as I was talking about enthesitis, the plantar fasciitis. You can see calcaneus spur. Here Achilles also you can see a spur. So whenever you see, these are called enthesopites. So there will be reactive new bone formation at the joint sites of enthesis. So whenever they are seen at multiple sites, again think of a spondylarthritis or a psoriatic arthritis. Here you can see the new bone formation. This is what I was referring to. Similarly, this is just a precursor of arthritis mutilans. There is severe destruction of the distal interphalangeal joint, erosion is there. This is called as the penciling cup. Sorry. So this is the cup, this is the pencil. It is called as a penciling cup deformity, which is very typical of psoriatic arthritis. So whenever the patient has inflammatory back pain, if it is going to be of long duration, ask for a simple extra pelvis. We will be able to make out sacroiliitis. Whereas if it is a very early this one, ask for an MRI. Here you can see there is bone marrow edema. In MRI, usually we see there is a sequence, we know T1 and T2. It is basically the stiff T2 sequence where we want to make out bone marrow edema. Whenever a patient has bone marrow edema, it is suggestive of sacroiliitis or spondylarthritis. So this can happen in psoriatic also. So this is something which is very underused, but unlike in Western countries where they use a lot, it's either the rheumatologist or the radiologist always do. So ultrasound is something, it's many of the conditions in musculoskeletal, if you have a good musculoskeletal sonologist, there is no need for an MRI at all, whether it is for the shoulder or other things. It's very easy, non-invasive and cheap. Only thing you should have a good sonologist who is able to do, or at least a good rheumatologist who can do that. So here is nothing but a plantar fascia. Here you can see it is not thickened, whereas here it is thickened. So just seeing this, we can make whether the patient has plantar fasciitis or not. Similarly, these two are pictures where you can see there is tendon inflammation. Similarly, here Achilles tendon inflammation is there. I am not going in detail into the pictures. So what are the risk factors? Now, obviously, one has seen psoriasis, family history. Sometimes they attribute even for gout, they tell, though it's not a proven entity, after a trauma, there is an attack of gout. Similarly, for psoriatic also, something like a cognos phenomenon, what we would have heard. In the skin, whenever there is a trauma, the patient can have worsening or initiation of psoriasis. Similarly, after a joint or tendon trauma, psoriatic arthritis can be there. And most important thing, whenever you see a patient with severe psoriasis, make sure you rule out HIV. So HIV patients present with severe skin lesions in particular, and sometimes they can also have some reactive arthritis. There are some classical skin lesions like keratoderma blepharogicum. So whenever you see a patient with severe skin psoriasis, think of HIV or rule out HIV. So coming to differential diagnosis, as I told rheumatoid, it will be a symmetrical arthritis. They won't have inflammatory back pain, they won't have a dactylitis, they won't have enthesitis. That is the major thing. Gout is the one, as I told, will be challenging, particularly when one joint is involved. So if it is going to be episodic arthritis, it comes, subsides, then again comes, it's more likely to be a gout. Whereas if it is going to be continuous, then it is more chances to be psoriatic. So take home message is, high uric acid, foot joint involvement is not always gout. Do think of psoriasis also and ask the history or try to see for any hidden areas of psoriasis. Then NOCOA is another condition. A simple X-ray will tell whether the DAP joint is involved. And if you can do inflammatory marker, it will be normal in osteoarthritis usually. Reactive arthritis usually it is a short duration. Otherwise, the symptoms are almost similar to a psoriatic arthritis. Tenous synovitis or other causes of dactylitis, they are quite rare. So coming to the management. So the most important thing, like rheumatoid, here also the patient comes to us basically for pain. They are not bothered about all our medical explanation. What they want is a pain relief and they want to do the daily activities. So the only drug which will give an immediate pain relief is NSAIDs. Steroids, it has no role in psoriatic arthritis. Sometimes it can even worsen some types of cutaneous psoriasis. So steroid is used very sparingly in patients who have some gross contraindication to a NSAID. So steroid, just remember, usually you don't use in psoriatic arthritis. Unless the patient has a severe form or has some contraindication to NSAID. Paracetamol, Tramadol, they really don't help in any inflammatory, whether it's rheumatoid or psoriatic. So it comes down to NSAID. So what are the synthetic DMARDs available? The traditional drugs are methotrexate, leflunomide. These are the ones which have quite a bit of evidence. Sulfur salicin is not very great. You can put it down the ladder. Now we have a new drug called apremilast. It is there in the market. It is a PDE4 inhibitor. So the standard drugs are methotrexate and leflunomide. But what we should remember with methotrexate and leflunomide, whether it is psoriatic or rheumatoid, they take 3 months for it to start acting. So till 3 months, what are we going to do? So we have to explain to the patient it takes time. So they can manage with the intermittent NSAIDs. I am not very comfortable putting for 90 days continuous NSAIDs. So what I usually do is give it for 2 weeks or 4 weeks, then ask them to take intermittently. The patient pain is really bad, then we have to think of some other modalities like biologicals. So this apremilast is something new molecule. Good thing about apremilast is it has no major organ side effects. Whereas for methotrexate and leflunomide, we know we have to monitor the counts, we have to monitor the liver function. Whereas for apremilast, there are no major side effects. It's not very costly, but little bit, like one tablet is around 35, in a day you might need one or two tablets. Compared to methotrexate or leflunomide, it's little bit costly, but compared to biologics, it's far cheaper. So it's a new one, it's a nice addition to have it. It's not very potent like methotrexate or leflunomide, but it is useful. Only thing we have to remember is, there is a chance of patient having severe diarrhea. So many of these companies actually, they give something like a starter pack. Though the dose is 30 mg twice daily, we start at 10 mg, 20 mg, go slowly. If the patient is not able to tolerate as diarrhea, there is no point in continuing. But if he is able to tolerate, there is no need for monitoring. So this is a new drug which has come. Sulfa salicin, if a patient has a gross liver problem, apremilast also is not able to tolerate, then you can think of it, but it's not a great drug. Coming to the biological DMARDs, so these are the traditional ones. I think many of you might have heard of it. TNF blockers, infliximab was the first one, etanercept was the first, followed by infliximab and these things. So TNF blockers, again, I think had a session on, I forgot what was it, spondyloarthritis only last time, I think. Problem with these biological is the cost. So in UK, the government pays for the patient. US, there is insurance reimbursement, but whereas here it is our patients who have to pay from the pockets. So here, even if most affluent patients also won't be able to take it on a long term, they take it maximum for 6 months or 1 year. So what we usually do is use it as a on-demand therapy, like use it for 3 to 6 months, try to bring the disease activity under control, and then follow it with the conventional drugs. Then we have a new addition called IL-17 inhibitor called secukinumab. So advantage with secukinumab is the risk of tuberculosis, which many of them are scared with TNF blockers, is relatively less. But again, patients can have, if they have an occult IBD, that can get worse, so they have to be careful. This is still not come into India, like IL-12/23. It is there in other Western countries. So I am not going into detail. Just remember, peripheral arthritis, we have to address inflammatory back pain, enthesitis, dactylitis, skin, nails, all these things we have to be addressed. So peripheral arthritis, it is easy. Like rheumatoid, we have methotrexate, leflunomide. Whereas for inflammatory back pain or axial pain, only choice is either it is a painkiller NSAIDs, or we have to go for a biologics. So this is the one, if you remember, it's enough. So peripheral arthritis, at least like rheumatoid, we can play with our conventional drugs. Whereas the patient has a pure spinal problem, then it has to be either a NSAID or a biologic. Similarly for enthesitis, dactylitis, that biologicals, they play a major role compared to our traditional drugs. So any patient for rheumatoid or psoriatic, before starting DMARDs or after starting DMARDs, we should vaccinate them because these patients are going to be immunosuppressed on a longer term. This is the most important thing. Many of these patients, as I told, have metabolic syndrome. Metabolic syndrome incidence is more in rheumatoid, psoriatic. So they have fatty liver, they have transaminitis, and particularly psoriatic patients, they don't tolerate methotrexate very well. They have even a 10 mg, 15 mg, the OTPT just shoots up. So that is a very important challenge in managing these type of patients. So also tell the patient to go for lifestyle modification exercise so that the fatty liver and other things are taken care of, so that we are able to use our psoriatic arthritis drug. The most important thing, many times most neglected part in our country. So tell the patient, don't just tell you have to blindly tell you have to take it for lifetime. Tell them the positively. First tell them, first let your pain come under control, let be pain free without a painkiller. Then you'll think about stopping. Tell them you give a period of 1 or 2 years to push the patient into remission. You don't just tell it has to be taken on a long term. Tell them there is a chance that some patients can go for a drug-free remission. So early initiation of therapy becomes very important. Fear of side effects, tell you if you periodically monitor the blood test, nothing to worry. Similarly for biologicals also, short-term biologics, touch wood, we don't see much of side effects. Usually all the data studies have been done for patients who are on biologics for 5 to 10 years, unlike India. And cause of pain, all patients with inflammatory arthritis, it's not the inflammation alone is the cause of pain. Even a mechanical cause can be there. So other than drugs, physio, again a neglected part, patient education we have to concentrate, and also the mental health many times. So these are all the drugs available. The cetralizumab is not there, ustekinumab is not there, ixekizumab is not there. So we have quite a wide spectrum of drugs for psoriatic arthritis, other than the conventional methotrexate and leflunomide. And with more number of pharma companies bringing products, actually the prices have been coming down for biologics. It's not so costly as it was some 3-4 years before. So this is a patient who was on a biologic. I'm not promoting any, so I'm not telling what product it is, but this was at the start of therapy, so within a few doses you can see how much the skin lesion has come down. So it plays a major part, particularly somebody who is like, there was a girl who was about to get married, so for them if you just use a biologic, it just disappears. So these things are something which you have to remember. So this is a new one here, it is called as CAFO, this ixekizumab. This is still not come in PTR, this is next to TNF progress. So take home messages, seronegative RA, always remember, it can be something else, particularly psoriatic arthritis, so look for it. Asymmetrical arthritis or predominant lower limb arthritis, think of psoriatic arthritis. Patient has inflammatory back pain with the peripheral arthritis, or a enthesitis like plantar fasciitis, Achilles tendinitis, peripheral arthritis, think of psoriatic. Dactylitis, either psoriatic or reactive unless proved otherwise. Hidden area of psoriasis, always look for it, and also ask for family history. And elevated uric acid with the arthritis, particularly foot arthritis, is not always good. It can also be psoriatic. I also take this opportunity that I have a CME on October 13th here in Green Park. So it's more of a panel discussions with the multiple specialties, rheumatology with the skin, rheumatology with the eye, lung. So whoever is interested can just give me or message me or names and contact details. Thank you.
Any questions?
What is the exact relationship between the psoriasis and joint? Why joint is affected? I mean, is there any commonality? What is the relationship between psoriasis and the joint?
What is
the
joint?
Basic pathogenesis.
So basically, it's like a problem is in the blood, like it's an autoimmune problem. So patients who have skin lesions, that means the same mechanism which happens in the skin, can also happen in the joints, and not only joints, it can affect the eyes, it can affect the bowel. I didn't go into the extra articular, means uveitis is very common. Similarly, they can have a inflammatory bowel disease. So basically the problem is, it's to do more of a what we call a type 1 response. We have Th1, Th2 immune mediated response are there, so it is more of a Th1 response. So the same mechanism which happens in the joints can also happen in the, skin can also happen in the joints. For some mechanisms like the DAP joint and the nail, so the if there is inflammation in the nail, actually the nail bit is considered as an enthesis. So it just involves the proximal joint or the nearby joint called the DAP. For some places it's due to the proximity, otherwise it's more of a systemic inflammation which involves multiple. Even there will be inflammation in the blood vessel also. They are more at risk for coronary artery disease.
Thank you. I have a from the same day, please come forward and have a certificate of decision.
Sir,